difference is with a coach, you get there faster. So I work with coaches as well. So I've got a PT coach, I've got a business coach who I work with weekly, who I have a half hour call. And the difference it makes is that we're only in February. I started with her in October, so it's a newer coach. And I'm already smashing this year's goals, and it's only midway through February, to the point where last week I had to have a conversation with her about, I'm kind of like, well, I'm done, I don't need to do anything else. And then we, you know, that's another place for growth. If I hadn't had a coach, I would have still done a lot this year, but I'd have probably just done one more live group and that would have been it. And actually now I've done the live group, I've got an online group, building a website and all the rest of it. So it's more efficient and it's more effective. And I think I can only speak for myself in coaching, but you know, I think that the same thing happens with my clients. If I'm procrastinating on something, if I'm just reading a book or watching a YouTube video of a coach, they're not calling me out on my crap. I can listen to it and intellectually I can go, oh yeah, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. But they're not going, oh, hang on a minute, you said X, Y, Z. And then I get to kind of see it. It's like having someone hold you accountable, but not in a kind of you must do it way, but just a, oh, you said that, do you still want to do it? And I find it easier to get the stuff done than have the conversation with my coach about why I didn't get it done. So it's very motivating, because she won't step over stuff. And it's the same with me when I coach people, I won't step over stuff. So if someone said they want to be in a relationship or they want to get financially free or they want their business to grow, I'll remember that. And I'll remind them of that and I'll keep them on track. Whereas when we work on our own, we tend to kind of do the easy wins and, you know, we get progress, but not as much. Avoiding looking at money is the massive one for me with my clients. So they don't even want to look at their bank statements. So the spreadsheet that I get everyone to fill out, some people just do it and it's fine and it works. Other people are just like, oh, I can't do it. You know, I mean, they get physical reactions to opening a spreadsheet and opening their bank statements. They don't want to look, it's scary, all of that. So there's that kind of thing that I'll coach them through. There are things like, I have a lot of clients who aren't in relationships, who end up getting in relationships while they're working with me. So, which sounds a bit weird because we're talking about money and property and financial freedom, but you can't do one bit of your life without, you know, looking at all the rest of it. So yeah, relationships is a massive one. I believe it's hugely important. Intimate relationships are our biggest playground and our biggest nightmare for bringing up stuff, biggest section area for growth. There's nothing, I don't think, more challenging than getting into a relationship in the sense of it dredging up, you know, the stuff we've got going on. I'd say money is even secondary to that. Things like spending, so clients, you know, committing to not just spending willy-nilly. Addiction to a certain extent, although if it gets too much, then, you know, I'll refer to other therapists and coaches and things that are specialists in that area. But yeah. So why it's important to have the right people around you and avoid, and I don't want to say wrong people like they're bad, they're just not in your goal. You know, they're not up for what you're up for. And it can be very destructive to ourselves if we've got someone who goes, and actually the most dangerous way of people doing it is they go, are you sure? I'm really worried about you. Are you sure you want to do this? I really care about you. That's almost worse than someone going, you're a fucking idiot, don't do this, da da da. Because if someone says that to you, you can just go, get out my life. Whereas when someone's dressing it up as kindness and caring, that's almost, that's toxic to a certain extent. And they mean it in a caring way. They're not doing it maliciously, but actually they're keeping you small. And what we need is, as people, life's really hard. You know, life's tough. It's not a bowl of peaches. I don't think, even in the first world where, you know, we've got everything we want, life is still tough psychologically. And if we don't have the right people around us to get us through the days when it's tough, then I don't know how people get through. I didn't get here by not having the right people around me. You know, I've had my mum as like a flipping rock behind me. I've had coaches, you know, even this morning at the gym with Sabrina, dealing with like feeling tired and not wanting to be there. And also like I've got a hip issue. You know, it's just kind of like it took her to kind of be there and create the space for that to be okay. So even I don't think it matters what stage of life you get to. You need the right people around you. And actually, the more success we get, the more money we get, the more everyone assumes that actually we don't need anything. And actually, I'd say we need it just as much as someone who's clearly struggling. And it's everything. And it's, and words can, you know, if someone that you care about or someone that you respect says something to you like, oh, I don't think you should do that, it's really powerful and it's tough to go against that. So I believe it's important for people to be careful about what they say to who, so that we can kind of self-protect, self-parent, we be vulnerable with the people that we trust, and we just, we're not so open with the people that we don't. And that's really important. There's a big issue with naivety, and people think, you know, just kind of oversharing and oversaying their goals, and it's just asking to be shot down. So I'd say it's not everything, but it's a really big key. It's why I put people in groups. It's why I'm not a big fan of one-to-one coaching. I'll do kind of one-to-one troubleshooting coaching. But actually, as you're seeing now in a group, it's really powerful being in a group because you've got like the support of other people and you're all going through the same thing. So I had people that I was in school with who, when they heard I was doing property stuff, I had some quite vicious messages on Facebook, you know, like, oh, who do you think you are? Look at you doing all, you know, I mean, that was kind of really blatant. And that was fairly easy to deal with. I just blocked, deleted and went, okay, they're not on my team. I think it's kind of, how do I say it? It kind of happens naturally over time. I think as I grow, there are people that grow with me, and there are people that I don't want to say left behind, and it's not a negative thing. People who are happy being where they are, it's fine. But when someone is going for a bigger goal, it's quite challenging. So if I'm going for a bigger goal, it challenges those people around me, and people have a choice. They can either go, this looks good, let's do it. Or they can go, you're nuts, I like my life, you know, I'm going to go the other way. So I wouldn't say it's like a, you know, when you see people doing like a Facebook cull, I've never done that. But there's just a natural fall away of certain people over time that just don't work, including probably some quite good friendships that the real ones have stood the test of time. And the real ones have, you know, I've been friends with people for, say, 10, 12 years. I moved a lot as a child, so I haven't got like childhood friends because we moved, you know, continents and countries. But the people I've had in adult friends, it doesn't really matter, you know, what I do and what they do, we're still really close. I think the other thing that people forget is it's the things we say to ourselves. So we might have our parents not saying anything, or they might even be dead. I've got clients whose parents are dead who are still running the show because that voice from when they were a child that they haven't dealt with or said, no, that's not okay anymore, is still there. So they'll go ahead to do something and then that voice will come in. So it's not even necessarily actual physical people. It's stuff that's happened in our past, things that people have said, concerns that we've got, things that aren't even relevant now that happened, you know, when we were children, which again, anyone who thinks they don't need to deal with their childhood, there's not a lot of places to go. It's huge what happened to us as children. Even if we had, you know, a seemingly nice childhood like I did, there was still a lot of stuff there to deal with. We don't just talk about money and property. We talk about boundaries, becoming bigger people, what we're up to. So yeah, I've had a couple of my guys in groups, and I think what's important is that the way that it's ended hasn't been like, oh, you're shit, I'm leaving, I'm growing. It's been really, you know, there's been children involved in some of these relationships. So it's actually been really powerful for everyone involved, because if a relationship's not working for one, it's not working for the other. And if there are children involved, it ain't working for the kids either. People who stay together, you know, for the kids, it's probably the worst thing I think they could do, because kids aren't stupid. They know on an energetic level, you know, what's going on. And what we do in our groups is that we hold each other accountable for being the best self we can be with our ex-partners. So especially when there are children involved, I encourage people to be a way that is really counterintuitive. So a lot of time a relationship breaks down, it goes sour, everyone blames everyone and everyone walks away and the kids are left in the middle feeling like they're responsible. The people that it's happened to in my groups, they are held accountable by the group and by me for being their best self around that relationship. And that's that's really powerful. So it's not just, oh, they've grown, left that person behind. It's they've grown in one direction, the other person is going in another direction, and both of them get to be their best self and be with people who they really want to be with. And it's that's really powerful. And from the outside, it might seem bad or wrong, but actually for the people that are, you know, going through it, it's the best outcome for everyone. I've had quite a few people get into relationships, yeah, since they've had coaching. I mean, you know, I'm with Owen, who's my husband now, through a mutual friend who's a coach, and through both of our journeys and doing the Landmark Forum and all kinds of other work. But I would say, I'm trying to think now, one of the last biggest groups that was all ladies, there's a few of them that are now in relationships or in a better place and even dating. One of the biggest things is people who aren't in a relationship have given up and they don't even go dating. So they'll have a goal of wanting children that they kind of sort of go, well, yeah, it would be nice. And then they're actually dating again. To me, that's a massive success, because you can't grow in that area without going on dates. I know it sounds obvious, but you know, a lot of people aren't. So I built a catering company a while back, and I've still got all of those kinds of relationships are really important to me. And I've still got all of those relationships from back then. And although I'm not doing catering anymore, and when I left catering, I thought, oh God, I'm gonna have to start again. You know, now I'm doing something from scratch. There's nothing from catering that's transferable into this. And actually there is, because I think when we are authentic and we are our best selves and we treat people with respect and all of the rest of it, that carries a lot of weight. So you'll see, if you look in my groups, the people that are in my groups have been with me or know me for a long time. So although I don't actively network now, I did do a lot, and you know, built up kind of a good network of people that know me and trust me. This is difficult to kind of say without making someone bad or wrong. And I don't want it to come across like there are people in our industry that are bad and wrong. They're not. They're doing what they do, and they're doing what they know how to do. I think the bit that's missing in what they do is they're selling a strategy, and they're selling a dream, and they're selling, look, I did it, therefore you can do it. I did it this way, therefore if you buy my course and follow what I did, you'll do it. And they're not doing anything malicious. But what they're doing is they're not realizing that human beings are different and everyone has different needs and everyone's got different shit. Everyone had a different childhood. Everyone needs a different strategy. So instead of, I kind of grappled with this for a couple of years myself, because I didn't want to become that. I didn't want people to see what I did and think, oh, I'll just do what Alex did and it'll be fine and we'll get on. So I focus a lot of my stuff on the actual people and what will work for them. And then we go and find the strategy and put it in. Whereas a lot of people in the property world are doing it the other way around. And it's not because, yeah, it's not malicious. It's because they just don't know. They're not people coaches first. They're property people who have done something really well and they're selling it. And it's based in like goodwill and wanting people to succeed, but they're missing, I believe they're missing a trick in really genuinely authentically helping people. And I think there's also a bit of a, I want to say an ethical issue when I've been on some of these courses years back, just, you know, interested in different subjects. And when people are on those courses who haven't really got a good grasp of English and who don't even understand what a mortgage APR rate is, but they're talking about rent to rent, that's an issue. You know, I don't want people on my course who haven't got a basic grasp. And if they haven't got a basic grasp, they need to do that with me first. And I think that's where the industry kind of falls a bit flat. There are crooks in our industry for sure. And they're just outright blatantly unforgivable. They're, you know, they're out for money. But there are people, there are con artists in every profession. Unfortunately, in property, there's a lot of money involved. You know, I can do a deal and make 100 grand, which, you know, most people would take 4 or 5 years to make that. When there's that level of money involved, there's a level to which corruption, you know, becomes a problem. But also there's a level to which, and it's a bit like we were saying earlier about naivety, people want to believe that it's going to happen. So they just do dumb shit. It's not even, you kind of, I look at them and I go, well, what did you think was going to happen?
Example?
Well, so a more legitimate scheme would be something like the student houses that they will send out adverts for 10% guaranteed rent for student housing. Just buy in, it'll be fine, 10% guaranteed rent. As soon as you ask that company, well, what happens if the company goes bust? Where's my guarantee? They won't even reply to the email. You know, and that's how I would stop it. But most people won't ask that question. They'll just go, oh, that sounds amazing. Let's go. There have been companies. My dad was involved in one of them. The guys are all in prison now, where he was effectively what they call an armchair investor. And again, I wouldn't recommend anyone does that because you don't know who you're giving your money to. But they basically sell deals, you know, source houses, sell deals, tell you that they'll do everything for you. So you just give us the money, you sit back, don't worry about it, the rent will come in. It's just nonsense. You know, these guys, basically, there were tenants involved. So again, this is horrendous playing with people's lives. So you've got the investors who basically get ripped off. The people that are tenants are genuinely paying the rent and the middleman company doesn't pass on the rent to the landlord. The tenant ends up getting evicted or losing the home because the house might get repossessed. I mean, it's just a complete mess. And the people who did the deal in the first place, they just walk away. Now, in this instance, they didn't. They all went to prison. But there's some pretty big stuff going on. And then you've got the smaller one-man band sources. I've dealt with one and managed to see the deals through. But he was basically doing a similar thing. You know, he was kind of, I think he got himself to a point where he didn't have enough money. So he kept doing deals and taking money from this deal to pay that deal. And it just, you know, it all came unstuck. And again, it's just trickery. And it's crazy when you can make money in property properly, you know. So I think people need to have their eyes wide open. They need to stop being so naive. They need to understand who they're working with. They need to get that you don't just pay a coach or a course. I think that's the other distinction, is that a lot of property people aren't coaches. They are teachers. So they are teaching, this is my strategy. And it makes no difference. We can all intellectually get a strategy. Can we get over ourselves to get it done? Not necessarily. And what's worse is people who haven't got their money sorted first, they go, oh yeah, I'm going to do that because that'll solve my money. And it doesn't work like that. That doesn't solve the money. That makes the money worse. However people do money today is however they will do money next week, next month, next year, unless they make a change. So lottery winners, they win the lottery. I think the stats are something like over 90% of lottery winners get, they're back to where they were or worse off within a year or two. And it's because however they did money before they won the lottery, they did it exactly the same with the millions. So most people spend all of their paycheck before the end of the month, struggle through, just about manage, usually have some form of debt. So if you win £1 million, guess what you do? You spend it all, you leverage up, you buy, you know, bigger cars and whatever, and you end up with a mansion house, a Range Rover or two on the drive, and no way of paying for it, which is exactly how they did it in their, you know, normal three-bed house like this. And if people don't deal with that first, it doesn't matter how much property you do or how many lotteries you win, you'll end up back to square one. They do need a certain amount of money. To be in my groups is £250 a month, so yes, they do. And to a lot of people, that's just an insurmountable amount. But for people who don't have that, there are ways of working towards that to get to that point to then, you know, get the next bit. I do a certain amount of free calls and, you know, strategies, books, whatever, that are coming. And so people do need to get themselves to a certain level. But I've also had people who go, well, I can cash flow that money, but I'm in debt and I'm struggling, but I'm going to push really hard to get, you know, for the money. The money course is 4 months, so they need £1,000. But when people are struggling, if that £1,000 gets them, you know, out of it in the long run, then it works. I never ask people to go into debt or any of that to pay for my courses. But most people, if they really want something, can find that money. So most people have probably £1,000 worth of stuff lying around their house they never use, they could sell on eBay. Most people could do an extra shift a week at work to pay for that. You know, it's like, I don't encourage going into debt for it, but actually most people have some kind of capacity in the short term to go, right, okay, you know, I need this, it's going to be good for me, I'm going to find a way. And I think, again, it's getting the psychology to look at that. It's amazing the number of people who present to me as if they can't afford it. And yet they do. And then when they do, they realise, oh, actually, I can do it. One of the biggest learnings in paying my fee is that, oh, actually, I can do it. I can stretch myself. I did survive. I didn't die this month because I paid an extra £250. And even in paying my fee, the lessons already start, because people kind of get, they go, oh, okay, I can do it. All the groups do different deals that suit them. And what the guys in one of my first groups did, they actually did an auction deal first. So they went to auction, they bought for cash, they did up, and they refinanced back out. So I think they bought in auction for about 40,000. So again, we're in Wales, for anyone watching this who's in London or, you know, southeast. The figures sound ridiculous, but it does happen. You know, we're doing it now. It's not something that happened 10 years ago. So they bought for about, I think they bought for about 40. Must have spent 8, something like that. If any of them are watching it and want to comment, then they can. It valued up, I think, at 75. So they ended up pulling most of the money back out. It's now rented to a tenant for about 400 a month. And it's cash flowing, and they need to manage it. So
positive cash flow straight away.
Yep, straight away. So they had a couple of months of, you know, doing the refurb. They learned a huge amount. And again, I can't teach in a video or in a classroom what people go through when they learn to do the refurbs. You know, this is not a peachy ride where it's just like, oh yeah, we just did a refurb. It was just, you know, it was just easy. They had fallouts in the sense of personality clashes. Things didn't get done when people said they were going to do. So they all grew a huge amount as well as doing the property. And they, yeah, it's rented out now, and they'll probably keep that forever. And effectively, I can't remember what they've got maybe 5,000 tops left in it. So for a £5,000 investment, when it all came out in the wash, they've got £200 a month. Show me a bank where you can get that, you know, or a share dividend or whatever. It just doesn't happen. The flip side is they get it wrong and it's completely devastating the other way. So, you know, I think that's where people who are interested in property, they get really kind of wide-eyed about the figures that work, but they don't realise the risk and the downside. So what those guys had to put in to get that reward was massive. They're all working full time, running their own businesses, and then they did this on top. You know, they were there at weekends or on a Friday night or, you know, on a call. I think they have their call on a weekday evening. I've got another group that have a call at 6 a.m. on a Friday morning because it's the only time when all of them can get together. One of my favourite deals so far that a group has done was one of the groups had a house already. And what landlords have dealt with in the last couple of years is a massive tax change whereby we can't claim, or we're starting to not be able to claim, mortgage interest relief. So basically we get tax on the gross rent minus maintenance. So 50% of our rent is usually mortgage on average. And all of a sudden that's not a claimable expense anymore. So in the context of dealing with that, the fact that this property hadn't been done up for maybe 10 years, she bought it with a tenant in it. So basically when you do that, you kind of leave them alone. It was their house. This was before buy and rent back got made illegal because there were some big companies doing some really nasty stuff. This lady, she did it ethically. She bought the house, she rented it back to them for a lower rent, and they lived there for years. They didn't really maintain the house. When they did finally leave, through all sorts, they had kind of tragic stuff go on. I think they lost a child, they weren't functioning, you know, very well. They ended up moving, and the house was a complete state. It needed a full refurb. I mean, everything needed doing. I can get you pictures, actually, probably, of that. And the lady was in a position where she didn't have the money to deal with the tax changes or do a refurb, so she would have basically had to sell. So it was worth, I think the mortgage was around 77,000, and she would have just had to go, well, I'll sell it for 77, I'll walk away, at least I haven't lost anything, and she's gained, you know, 10 years or whatever of positive cash flow. And it was right at the time where I was putting a new group together, and so I said, let's look at this deal in the group. One of the guys put 25k in for the refurb. She put the property in. One of the other guys did all of the sort of bookkeeping and keeping receipts and checking of figures and all that kind of thing. One of the other guys did the refurb. And basically they did it together, and they trusted each other to sort of, you know, see it through. They spent about 20,000, 25,000. They were at 77 of a mortgage. They sold it for 140. They made 35, 40 grand, you know, after all the fees and everything. They took that money, which they literally created from what they had. So no one of them individually could have done that deal. And some people go, oh, why would she do that? Why didn't she do it herself? She could have made that 40 grand herself. The reality is she wouldn't. She wouldn't have done it. She didn't have the time to manage the refurb. She didn't have the cash or the resources to pay for it. She couldn't have got a bank loan. And even if she could, she still didn't have the time and the resource. And I think that's when people are making money, they forget that the joint venturing is not just the money. It's the time and the brain power and the planning and the showing up. So they took that 35 grand. They've now bought an HMO, which is a 5-bed HMO, which was ready tenanted. It needs some work and they'll have maintenance, higher than normal maintenance costs over time because they're going to do it while people are living in there. But they've instantly got, I think that cash flows between £600 and £800 per month after mortgage, and the mortgage is an allowable expense because they bought it in a company together. So five people came together with effectively not a lot. You know, each of them had a bit of something and they've walked away making profit, buying a house. So that house that they've now got, the HMO, it's basically like, the returns are infinite because all of their money's back out, and the money will come in, you know, for the rest of their lives. So that's what happens in joint venture. That's the difference between joint venture and trying to do it on your own. You know, it's magic. And they're now going on to buy, you know, their next deal. One of the things that we lack right now in 2019 is connection and the sort of tribal being together. We've got Facebook and we've got YouTube and we've got all this stuff that's meant to connect us, and all it does is mean we're all sat in our houses on our own thinking about stuff. And what it does is it brings people together. So they've got connection and they've got a common goal and they've got camaraderie. And that's missing a lot in the world today. I mean, we don't even have that in a family system so much anymore. Families are so fragmented, whether it be physically because they're all over the country. You know, like my grandma lives up north in Staffordshire. I've got an auntie in France. My dad was in Tanzania. My mum was in Cyprus. Now they've both moved back now. But it's really fragmented. So we kind of lose that tribe of who we're with. And if I work one-on-one with a client, I can't give them that. It's much more expensive to work one-on-one. So that's the kind of mindset stuff of what it does for people. So they feel like really involved. But from a practical point of view, if I work one-on-one with someone, it costs a lot of money. You know, people are spending $250 a month with me. If they work one-on-one, it's $250 an hour because that's what my time's worth versus going and doing a property deal. And so they also get a lot more contact. If you were one-to-one with me, we might speak for half an hour a week. But when you're in a group, we have an hour as the group together. You guys will have like calls together without me. And then we've got a day a month together. So it's really powerful for being with people. And it's a really safe space to kind of deal with stuff. And you can't fix yourself. You can't do stuff on your own. It's like we need other people to bring up the stuff. So it's not all peachy. You know, we'll get challenged by other people in the group. But that's where the work is. You know, the gold is in the breakdown. If everyone's doing fine, they don't need me. You know, what's the point? They can just kind of carry on their own. So it's just massively powerful. And especially going back to like who you have around you is important. A lot of people don't have positive people around them. If they are in a job, like an average day job, where they're just literally exchanging time for money, they don't really enjoy it. So an office job and I'm talking about, they have it that they don't enjoy it. There are plenty of people that work in an office. They love their lives. They do what they do and they have their hobbies and it's peachy. And do you know what? More props to them, because I wish I could be like that, because this is quite a tough road to go on. So if someone is not happy in their job and they don't really see people who support them and get them to, you know, come on, and they watch TV, you know, even just watching an hour of TV a day with all the adverts and all the crap that we get thrown at us, watching the news, you know, all of that, it kind of has this effect that, you know, it's like life is shit, the world is hard. You know, anyone would think we're living in the hardest time in history, and actually it's the safest. But you watch the news and it gives you the other idea. So this the groups counter that.
Yeah. I noticed within the group and under your coaching, there's sort of complete honesty and openness.
Yeah.
There's nothing, there's like, you know, everybody's, all the various struggles that people have got in their life is out on the table, and there's no judgment. And you don't have to worry about, oh, so, you know, somebody's going to be judging me because I got a credit card debt.
Yeah.
Nothing like that.
Yeah.
Everything's safe, everything's open, everything's honesty. And that does create strong bonds, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's huge. Yeah. Vulnerability and being... And I'll really caveat that you've got to be vulnerable in a place where it's safe to be vulnerable, and I will create that, and I won't step over stuff, and I won't allow, you know, things going wrong. If there's something not right, you know, we can feel it as human beings. We know something's not right. We'll deal with it. And if we have a safe place to be vulnerable, that the connection is enormous. You know, people kind of get scared of being vulnerable because then they think everyone will, you know, not like them, or like you say, judge them or whatever. But actually the reality is, when someone's vulnerable in the right place, everyone else goes, yeah, me too, you know. And and that's just, it gives me goosebumps thinking about it, you know, because everyone goes, oh, it's not just me, you know. So a lot of people have shame around money for varying reasons. I think one of the most powerful things to do is distinguish it and shine a light on it. So again, if we're vulnerable in a group and we say, you know, I've got this debt. So let's use debt as the biggest example. So the biggest shaming inducing things around money are debt, not earning enough. So perceiving that we should earn more than we do. Spending money on things that we perceive we shouldn't. So anywhere there's a should or a shouldn't, there's some outside force. Lights going. There's some outside force basically saying, imposing will on us. It's not what we believe, it's like what we believe other people believe. And whenever you get that, there's going to be shame. And the best, quickest way to deal with shame in the right place, and I can't caveat that enough, you know, you don't just go out into the street and speak to someone on the bus stop and go, hey, I'm in debt and it'll all be okay. You know, that doesn't work. Although you'd be surprised sometimes, you know, actually people go, yeah, me too. But shining a light on that, it dissolves the shame. Shame grows in the dark, it grows in secrets, it grows in lies, it grows in hiding. So when we get vulnerable and we say, I've got this debt, or I've got this spending habit, or I don't think I earn enough, or whatever, it vanishes. Brené Brown talks a huge amount about that, about courage and vulnerability. And the more we are courageous and vulnerable, and the two are intrinsically linked, the more the shame like dissipates and goes away, because it grows in the darkness, it grows in the secrets, it grows in the hiding, it grows in the avoiding. You know, it's like debt. When people are in debt, they don't get in communication, the debt grows. They don't get in communication with the credit card company or the bailiff or however far it's gone. And all that happens is it gets worse and worse and worse. And if actually, when they got the credit card bill and they knew they couldn't pay it, if they'd have picked up the phone and said to the credit card company, I can't afford this, which sounds so simple, but it's really tough for people to do, the credit card company would have gone, okay, we understand. We're going to freeze the interest. We're going to freeze your card. Let's set up a payment plan. And that would be it. But people don't. They hide. They vanish. They don't pay. Their credit score gets devastated. And then all of a sudden, there are literally bailiffs on the door. You know, it's gone that far. And then you have to pick up the pieces of, you know, 6 years of things on your credit file before you start to really get decent credit again. And it's all from hiding. And it's all from shame. Getting in communication and saying, I can't cope. It's one of the hardest things to do, but it's actually also the most powerful. It's the same with depression or any kind of struggle. You know, we live in a society where we're meant to have it all, be it all, do it all. We're told, well, you're in the first world, you shouldn't have problems. So then, you know, we think, well, you know, who am I to have this problem? But the reality is, if we've got a problem, you know, we've got to deal with it. I've sat in a Codependence Anonymous meeting thinking, why am I here? These people have had the crap beaten out of them and they have genuine reasons to have issues. You know, who am I? But actually the reality is I've got, you know, I had issues that I needed to deal with. The quickest way to explain a codependent, the name came out of Alcoholics Anonymous. And the codependent, just to give a really kind of visual example, the codependent is the person that stays with the alcoholic. So the alcoholic's kind of got this reason for acting crazy. They're addicted to alcohol, they're literally drunk, and they're, you know, acting up and their lives aren't functioning. A codependent isn't drunk, they're just staying there. So they are addicted to helping. So when I was a codependent, and, you know, I am a recovering codependent, and however, you know, we word it now, my natural tendency, if I don't consciously think about it, is to overhelp, is to overgive, is to accept behavior that's not acceptable. So if you take it back to like the drunk person and the non-drunk person will accept, you know, spending of money that's not acceptable. Someone being drunk in their presence all the time, it often escalates to violence, whether it be verbal, physical, psychological, whatever. And they don't, codependents tend to not self-protect and not grow. So they're boundaryless to an extreme. And again, it's a spectrum. So there are lack of boundaries. There's lack of saying no. There's lack of just self-regulating emotions. And again, it all comes from childhood. And then also, you know, stuff that happens later on. And it's a dance between the alcoholic and the codependent. And between, you know, there's a lot of stuff in the press now about narcissism. And, you know, it's a wrong way of reporting, actually. The way we kind of go, oh, narcissists are bad and wrong. It's like, no, they're just people with a coping mechanism. Like codependents are people with a coping mechanism. And what happens is the codependent, the narcissist, they get in a dance and then neither of their lives function. Unfortunately, we kind of go, oh, the codependent's the poor victim and the narcissist, the big bad wolf. And actually, they're both just human beings struggling with their shit, and it kind of comes out in different ways. Anyone that stays in a situation that's not safe, or anyone that goes back to something that is not okay, there is a lack of self-respect, self-love, self-care, and it's like putting others first. So there are, you can actually go to the CODA website, and there are characteristics and traits, and there are four different styles of codependence. And quite often, anyone who looked at that and said, oh, do I do any of that, everyone on some level will do levels of that. And also, a codependent and a narcissist are actually doing the same thing in a different way. So a codependent will manipulate and people please, whereas a narcissist will outright go, this is what I want, you'll do what I say. The behavior is the same, and actually a narcissist much more easy to deal with because they say it like it is. A codependent, you never really know if you're ever with someone and they're saying yes, but you think they really want to say no, or you find you don't want to ask them because you know, like, you can't trust that they'll say no if they can't do it. That's kind of codependent behavior, and everybody to some level will have some form. It's a spectrum, you know. But the more people grow and have boundaries. So a lot of my clients would tend to, you could say that they are on the more codependent side of things. People tend to kind of gravitate to coaches who are similar to them. So it's about, yeah, overgiving, over people pleasing, high naivety trait. So believing that everyone's good and nice is just simply not true. Falling for scams, you know, because we can't imagine that someone would rip us off. It's all of those kinds of traits, and it takes something to, first of all, distinguish them. So first step of any 12-step program is, I have a problem, my life isn't functioning, including in CODA. And then the next step is, okay, where am I responsible? How did I set this dynamic up? Rather than, oh, they did this to me. It's like, hang on, how did that dance happen? How did I allow that? And as soon as people have got the power of, actually, I allowed that, then they can change it. Whereas unfortunately what happens is people get kind of, oh, poor you, you got ripped off, let's make you okay. Rather than saying, oh, hang on a second, you got ripped off, let's have a look at how that happened so we can stop it happening again. And that's, you know, again, you could say, what the hell's this got to do with money and property? It's got everything to do with money and property. I'd say we spend 70% of the time on this stuff and 30%, you know, on the deals. So anyone who's watching this who's like, I just want to do property, I don't want to deal with that shit, don't come see me. Just don't. Because you can't. They're so intrinsically linked. You can't be successful with your money and your property unless you deal with who you are and what happened to you and how you function and what your weak points are.
Because it's going to show up in yeah. business deals.
Yeah. And the more money that gets involved, it's like, I think it's Tony Robbins says, money's just a magnifier. You know, and it's the same as like the people that win the lottery. They just do the same that they were, but they do it big and everyone goes, oh my God, they've like totally failed. Well, on some level, they're failing every month by not saving and by not whatever. And it's the same. You start putting property deals on top of a human being that is not really functioning. They're going to do with that property deal what they do with everything else in their life. And I don't mean that in that like the people I work with are amazing. The people that come and work with me, they're not, you know, they're not like dysfunctional, useless people. They're people who are like, I want to rock this world, and I know I've got my limitations and I want to deal with them. You know, it's not a powerless place to be. It's actually, the more we distinguish our kind of bits that are holding us back, the more we can deal with them. It's intense, right? And it's deep. And that is the reality of working with me. It's not, oh, let's look on right move. We do that too, but it's like, oh, what's going on underneath? I think it started way before I became a coach and I had coaches. So I went to the Yes Group in Cardiff, which is kind of an offshoot of Tony Robbins. It's where I met you way back. I mean, that's 14 years ago. So it's a long time. And I remember seeing, so I was already into it because I came to the Yes Group and just thought, oh, there's something going on here. My mum had done all the Tony Robbins stuff and I love learning. I hated school, but I love learning when it's, you know, what I'm interested in is probably the right way to say it. And I remember seeing Judy Mae Murphy speak and just thought, she is freaking cool. I want her to be my coach. And until that point, I'd not met anyone who I wanted to coach me. I think it's really important that people find the coach that resonates with them. I'd seen a lot of coaches and just thought, nah, you're not going to help me. And I saw Judy Mae speak and I just thought, I'm not going to be able to hide from you. You're going to spot when I'm lying and when I'm avoiding, which is what a lot of clients do with a coach, right? So I've met coaches that I could just go, yeah, I'm fine. And they'd be like, oh, okay, that's good then. You don't get to do that with a good coach. And so I started my journey by working on myself and I got a lot of results and I got, you know, I did the property stuff and I did stuff with my chef career and I just, my life started working better. There was nothing really wrong, but I'm going to describe what that's like. So nothing really wrong was, I used to smoke, I used to drink, I wasn't that healthy, my relationships weren't that great. And if I knew now what I knew then, a lot of stuff would have functioned a lot better. So I think it's really important to say, you don't have to have a life that's going off the rails to need coaching. It's not because something's broken. It's about making it better and achieving on what you want to achieve on. And even knowing what you want. Most people don't even know what they want. So it was that for me. It was like, oh, hang on, there's something here. I can, you know, this is really powerful. And the way I describe it is, we would never go through a year of school again and again and again and again. The adults around us would say, no, it's time to move up to the next level now. Now you need to learn the harder stuff. And then we leave school and no one does that for us anymore. And people get into this trap of living the same year again and again and again. And you'd never let a child do that. I wouldn't take Charlie, who's 6 months old, and just let him just be what he's being now and not ever teach him anything. And I think as adults, it's really important to kind of self-parent and grow ourselves. So it started with Judy Mae. I did Tony Robbins, UPW. We went on Eric Edmeads. I think we went on a couple of his weekends. T. Harv Eker. I did a huge amount of like watching stuff later on YouTube. So the Spartan Life Coach, Richard Grannon's great. Jordan Peterson. I mean, the content now on YouTube is just astronomical. Brené Brown, read all her books. Landmark Forum, Landmark Advance, probably that's the most recent thing. And you know, that really, it's had the biggest impact, Landmark, but I think because it was sat on top of all the other work I'd done, I was totally ready to own my shit and own all my relationships that weren't working. So it's just been a massive ongoing journey. And I always look for coaches who are going to like get to the nitty gritty. I'm not in for kind of an easy ride. I like challenges. I like getting through challenges. It's my personality type. Some people need coaches that are not, you know, that are kinder and a bit more, you know, gentle and quiet. But again, that's self-awareness. Everyone's got to figure out what they need and work with the people they resonate with. There will be plenty of people who will see me speak and just go, oh my God, what a nightmare. I couldn't work with her. And there'll be plenty of people who go, oh my God, I've been looking for this person for ages. And it's literally finding people, you know, that resonate with. Part of it was my coach telling me that's what I needed to do because I was kind of helping people anyway. That's probably a bit of a codependent side. So she basically said I'm not allowed to volunteer or help people for free anymore because codependents are very good at doing that. So it kind of, I was always helping people with food. So I used to do a lot of like food coaching and teaching people with food. And I was kind of speaking, but about food, you know, doing cookery demos. So I kind of knew that I was good at helping people and good at showing people stuff. But the food side of it wasn't enough. And I was getting really frustrated with nutrition and the whole people asking what's the best thing for them to eat. It's not an area I want to coach in. I remember reading Louise Hay in her book, You Can Heal Your Life, saying the one area that everyone's different is nutrition, and everyone has to find what works for them. So some people can eat dairy, some people can't. Some people can eat wheat, some people can't. Some people need to eat paleo, some people need to be vegans. And we've all got to figure that out for ourselves. At that point we figure it out, we can go and find the people that are, you know, doing that. But nobody can tell us what's right for our body. We know, you know, when we eat. So it was kind of, I was like banging my head against a brick wall with that because I didn't want to tell people what to eat. What also happened, I was doing supper clubs and teaching people to cook, but they kept asking me about my properties. So we'd be doing a supper club and I'd be talking about property. So it kind of evolved there. And then my coach saying, if you're going to help people, you need to charge because otherwise they don't value it. And I really got that because I'd been paying for coaching. And whenever anyone gives me free advice, it's like, whatever, there's no value to it. But if I'm paying, you know, my coach now, it's £6,500 a year for half an hour a week. Not even a week, it's 40 sessions. You know, you guys can do the math. You can bet your bottom dollar I show up on that session like on time, if not early. I'm sat there before the session. I do the stuff I say I'm going to do. I value it. The more I've paid for coaching, the more I value it. I think coaches do their clients a disservice when they don't charge, because then the clients can't value it, because we can't value what we don't spend money on. You know, that when I buy more expensive clothes, I really look after them. If it says dry clean it, I do. If I buy cheaper clothes, I just, you know, they end up getting wrecked really quickly. I just want to help people, which again, part of the codependent coming out in me, but it really is a want for people's lives to function. There's no better feeling than a client coming to me saying, hey, you know, that thing, I've done it, I'm sorted, or I'm in a relationship, or I'm out of debt, or I've bought my first, you know, watching my groups buy the houses. It's unbelievably pleasurable for me. It's a very selfish thing what I do, you know, the whole giving thing. It's a selfish act when we really look at it, you know. It makes me feel good what I do. So my next level is, as well as the like community of people getting financially free, that the impact of that is magical, because those people then go and fulfill on what they want. So, you know, I've got clients who want an end to single use plastic. I've got a real passion about homelessness and how, you know, if I'm involved in property, that can't work. So there's a homelessness project in there about really getting to the root of why it happens and how to help people. Massively close to my heart, because I've had someone who I, you know, one of the chefs that first took me under their wing, he actually died in December, homeless and in and out of prison, drug addicted, you name it. I mean, horrific story. And he was the chef that, you know, said, come and be in kitchens, and had it all together. So huge homelessness project at some point. But again, we've got to put our own oxygen masks on first. I can be much more powerful if I create a community of people around me to then go and work on this stuff. If I just did that first, there's only so much I can do with the time, money and resource I have. So my goal is build up the resource to then really go at it and actually be able to make a difference. I'd like a livestock farm. I'm passionate about food and about eating the right food. You know, I'd like to live to 125 and die in a snowboarding accident. It's one of the exercises I do with my clients. And to do that, I know I need to eat right. I need to exercise right. I need to, you know, sort this out. There is a huge problem in this country, in the West, of how we treat animals. And I don't mean from a cruelty point of view, yes, but from a purely selfish nutritional point of view, when we feed animals crap and we fill them with antibiotics, we are not eating great meat. And so there is the cruelty side, there's the nutritional side, there's the animal welfare side. And so I believe that no one's coming to save us. If I'm passionate about that, I need to get off my arse and do it. So my way of doing that is having a farm. I also believe it's an incredible place to bring up children. So we want to have another 2, maybe 3 kids, if I can get my head around the labour. So I see a big farm, livestock animals. We'd also like vegetable garden. I see joint venturing with young farmers who can't afford land. There's a huge problem in this country where there are people who are passionate about farming and they can't farm because they haven't got the money. So we gonna, you know, I can build the money, I can have the farm, and I don't have, there's only one of me, there's only so much I can do, so I can then joint venture with young farmers and say, look, here's the land, what do you want to do? You know, and do projects. So joint venturing isn't just money and property. It's like, the more as human beings we joint venture and put passions together, the more, you know, the world changes. And it sounds like a big thing, but it's like, if we don't work towards that, what's the point? You know, why are we here if that's, you know, we're all doomed, we're all gonna die anyway, so we may as well do something that makes a difference. So if people like what they hear me say and people wanna work with me, they can. So I'm guessing if you're watching this video, there'll be somewhere on this page a way that you can basically jump on. But the way to get involved is just take that leap of faith. You know, get on the calls, get on the online program, come and work with me, come and meet other people who have got a common goal, and just join in and do the work, do the assignments, do the stuff that's asked, and that makes the difference. Don't watch this video and think, oh yeah, that would be really cool, and then, you know, go back on Facebook and forget all about it. Like, actually take the step and book it, especially if you've been saying for a long, long time, I'm going to sort my money out. You want to sort it out? Come do it, but you've got to take action. You've got to come and, you know, book online, join the group, join the tribe, and come and work.